भुष्यते यस्य नगरे रंगयात्रा दिने दिने तमहं शिरसा वंदे राजानं कुलशेखरं। लास्ट टाइम दिस फर्स्ट इंट्रोडक्टरी श्लोक वाज एक्सप्लेन्ड इन डिटेल। देर आर टू मोर स्टोरीज कनेक्टेड विथ कुलशेखर आळ्वार। Both these stories are very interesting, so I'll narrate them today in the beginning. It is said that once Kulashekhar Alwar had arranged the recitation of the Ramayana in the palace. A large number of people had gathered. He was also there, listening to the story of the Lord Shri Ramachandra. The Pauranika was reciting that portion where Khara Dushanan Trishiras came to the Dandakaranya and were about to attack Shri Ramachandra. So there Valmiki has said that they came with 14,000 demons, with chariots, with horses, with elephants. They were about to attack Sri Ramachandra and kill him. And Sri Ramachandra was all alone. He was barefooted. He was standing on the ground. Immediately, Kulashekhar Alwar got up, called the Prime Minister, "Come on, immediately get the army ready. Let us go to Dandakaranya." But the Prime Minister was very intelligent. He had anticipated this. He had already indicated to the Pauranika what to do. Immediately, the Pauranika jumped the intervening shlokas and read the last shloka, which announced the victory of Sri Ramachandra. "Sir, there is no need to go. Our Lord has finished all the 14,000 Rakshasas." "Yes, that is good." He sat down. This is one story. The second story is directly connected with this. Rangayatra dine dine yasya nagare ghushyate. Every day it is announced that about Srirangayatra or on Srirangayatra, people are urged to go and visit the holy place. The story is this. One day, Kulashekhar Alwar decided, "Enough of my kingdom and kingship. So let me put my son on the throne, go to Srirangam and settle down permanently." He announced to his Prime Minister, "So tomorrow I am going to Srirangam, settle down there. Rangayatra is announced. Kushyate." Now, neither the Prime Minister, nor the people, nor even the prince were ready for this. They wanted him to stay there. "You are such a nice and good king, and very heroic also." So the Prime Minister hit upon a stratagem. Next day, when the king is ready to leave, about 12 Brahmanas, Sad Brahmanas came. So when the Brahmanas came to the palace, he had no alternative. He had to receive them properly, look to their welfare and all, because he was a great lover of the and respecter of the Brahmanas. So the whole day was spent in taking care of them. So in the evening, when the Brahmanas left, the Prime Minister came and coolly told him, "Sir, today it is too late. Nale hogana. Let us go tomorrow." "All right." So next day also it was announced, "Ghushyate yasya nagare rangayatra dine dine," every day. And the story repeated the second day, third day. Fourth day, a large number of people came, hungry people. They had to be fed and clothed. How can there be poor people in my country? So taking care of them, the whole day was gone. And the fifth day the news came that some robbers were attacking in one corner of the country. So he had to get one contingent in the army and then send them, anxiously wait till he got the news. Like that, every day something or the other would happen. Though Rangayatra would be announced every day, he couldn't make it. So this is the other story. Now coming back to the first shloka, Shri Vallabheti Varadeti. We had just completed an explanation of the first word, Shri Vallabha, one who was very dear to, who is very dear to Shri or Lakshmi. Then the second word, Varada. Vara is that which we ask for. Boon, the one who gives. One who gives boons to those who ask for it. Now, you can never give boons unless you have it with you. You must have something to give, then only you give it. He has become Varada only because he is Shri Vallabha. Because Shri is there, therefore he is able to give varas. He has wealth, he has power, he has all the good things of life under his control. So when people come and ask, he is able to give them plentifully. There is also another interpretation. Lakshmi is also known as Daya. You have perhaps heard of Daya Shatakam by Vedanta Deshika. 100 shlokas on Mother Lakshmi as Daya or compassion. You may have so many things with you, but unless you have that feeling for others out of compassion, you will never give. In this world there are many people who have plenty of things to spare, but they are miserly, they don't give it to others. It's only a person who feels for others, compassion, love, only such a person can give. Now the Lord is able to give only because he is associated with Lakshmi, who is wealth, who represents wealth, who is Daya also because she is compassion incarnate. Impelled by her compassion, he gives the boons to the devotees. Our Somnathanji used to tell us a very interesting story. A gentleman had only one son. He was just appearing for the SSLC examination, and the father told him, if you get first class, I will give you a Parker fountain pen. Of course, as usual, the boy got only third class. But he was very much interested in getting the fountain pen. The father said, nothing doing. You didn't come in first class, so I won't get it. Then he went to the mother and pleaded with her, Mother, father has already purchased his pen and kept in the almirah. What will he do with that? Anyhow, I will utilize it. I'll better luck next time. Then the mother went to the father and started arguing. No, you must give. No, I had only promised that I would give it to him only if he took first class. Then the wife coolly told him, you belong to the Janata class. What can you expect of your son? He also belongs to the same Janata class. So like Janata trains and Janata class, first class, second class, Janata class. And then the father had to yield and give. Because it's a funny story, but the idea is very clear that what we cannot get directly from the father, we can get through the mother, because mother is all love and compassion. So similarly here also, Mother Lakshmi is also Daya. So she intervenes according to Visishtadvaita philosophy and tradition. She intervenes on behalf of the devotees and then make the Lord grant them what they want. In the Vishnu Sahasranama, Bhagavan Shankara defines this as Abhimatan Varan Dadati. He will not give simply whatever he wants to give. He will give those things which the devotees want. You want this, all right, take. You want this, you take. Abhimatan Varan Dadati. The Lord gives varas or boons not only to us, the devotees, but even to the gods in heaven. We find in the Puranas very often gods going to Lord Vishnu and praying to him for succor, for help, for destroying the Rakshasas. He is Varadatri even for the Devatas. Then Dayapara. Dayapareti. Nobody who has no compassion in his mind, in his heart, can give varas. As I just now pointed out, you may have things with you, but there must be the desire to give out of compassion, out of love. He is dayapara. For him, daya is everything. In one sense, daya is compassion. The whole creation belongs to the Lord. We are all His children. Therefore, it is but natural for the Lord to have compassion upon us. And in addition to that, daya or compassion is also pictured as the consort of the Lord. In one sense, it is His quality. In another sense, it is His consort. Lakshmi is known as daya. Therefore, since he is always associated with Lakshmi, who is daya or compassion, since he has got plenty of love and affection and compassion towards the devotees, therefore he gives varas, varada. He is varada because he is dayapara. In fact, in the Daya Shataka, there are two very interesting shlokas. Both are interesting from the standpoint of the explanation of the word given here. Vrishagiri grihamedhi gunaha bodhabala aishwarya virya shakti mukaha dosha bhaveyurete yadinam dayetvaya vinabhutaha. The poet Vedanta Deshika is addressing the mother as daya, compassion incarnate. Vrishagiri grihamedhi gunaha Venkateshwara, the Lord of Vrishagiri. He has got so many wonderful, blessed qualities. They are called as Bhaga, Bhagavan. Bhaga means all the blessed, great, good qualities, and he is the very personification of that. So all these gunas, for instance, bodha, knowledge, wisdom, bala, strength, aishwarya, wealth, virya, valor, shakti, power, he has got so many things. Dosha bhaveyuhu ete yadi nama daye tvaya vina bhutaha. O mother, if you were not by his side, these very great qualities will become defects. We imagine a person who has all these things but who has no compassion in his heart. He will become a ruthless dictator. If God has not become a ruthless dictator, it is because of you. You have practically toned down his mind and his heart. The very same great qualities he is using for the good of the world. In another shloka, he finds fault with daya as nirdaya, without any mercy or compassion. That is also very interesting. Kamala nilayahatvaya dayaluhu karune nishkaruna nirupanetvam atayevahi tavakashritanam duritanam bhavatit. Tvadeva-bhītihi. Word has spread But Mother Lakshmi is Daya, very personification of compassion. So everybody is rushing to her to get her grace, get what they want. And seeing this as a great opportunity, all sins also have rushed to her. The papas in the world, sins, they have also rushed. But Mother is very clever. She is compassion to everybody, but nirdaya, nishkaruna towards the papas, towards the sins. So, though you are daya, you become nirdaya, nishkaruna, all your mercy and compassion will disappear. You become very harsh, you become the destructive power towards the sins. So they are afraid now. Of trying to approach you, they run away. The idea is that Mother is compassionate towards the devotees and she destroys all the evil. Suppose the devotees go to the Lord, associated with Daya or Lakshmi, then what will happen? They will get what they want, provided it is good. If there are sins in their heart, they are destroyed by the compassion of the Mother. So the Mother who is Daya is also Nirdaya only in the sense that she has no compassion towards the evil in our minds and hearts. But we need not worry. We go, because after all she is our Mother, and the result will be all that is bad and evil in us will be destroyed by her grace. Bhakta Priyaha. Many of these words are repeated in the Vishnu Sahasranama Stotra also. And Vishnu Sahasranama has two standard beautiful commentaries. The earlier one is by Shankara. The later one is by Parashara Bhatta. Parashara was a disciple in the Ramanuja tradition. The difference between the two commentaries is, in Shankara's commentary, the explanations are very simple and direct, and plenty of quotations are given from the scriptures. But in the second commentary, Parashara's commentary, it is more grammatical and technical. Parashara tries to evolve each word from the root word, root verb, and then expound the meaning from that standpoint. So according to him, every word is full of meaning and the meaning is contained in the root verb itself. So in a way it is more technical, more grammatical, more scholarly. But both the commentaries are very helpful to us in understanding the Vishnu Sahasranama. He is Bhakta Priya. Bhaktanam Priyaha. Bhaktaha yasya priyaha saha, both are possible. He is dear to the devotees. That is one explanation. Devotees are dear to him is another explanation. Both are possible. Bhakta vatsalaha. The Vishnu Sahasranama, the word bhakta vatsalaha is used. One who is the darling of the devotees. The devotees like him and love him. Therefore, he is Bhakta Vatsala. Here it is Bhakta Priya. He is dear to the devotees are dear to him. Once Narada asked the Lord where he normally resides. The Lord replies, Naham vasami vaikunthe yoginam hridaye nacha madbhakta yatra gayanti. Tratishthami Narada. I don't reside in Vaikuntha, nor do I reside in the hearts of the yogis. I reside wherever my devotees sing my names and glories. Madbhakta hayatra gayanti tatra tishthami Narada. The Lord is fond of listening to Sankirtana, therefore, wherever we sing his names and glories, do bhajan, singing, the Lord is present there. That doesn't mean the Lord will be present wherever we sing, in whichever way we sing. Long back, I had gone to our Madras Mutt. I don't remember which year. One brahmachari, young brahmachari who had just joined probably 3 or 6 months earlier, he had a fairly good voice and he was conducting the prayer. So I attended the prayer, and then afterwards he came and asked me, "Maharaj, how was the bhajan?" So obviously he wanted that I should speak a few words of appreciation. Then I told him, "You see, just when you started the bhajan, somebody was going out. Then I saw Sri Ramakrishna was going out. He was waiting outside the compound. After the bhajan was over and jaikar was given, usappa, he came back." So that boy was very much downcast, and then I told him, "These are the things to be followed. Remember, before you expect or ask for appreciation, there are some preconditions. Muncha shruti sersi harod kalyappa, raga thala sariyagirbeku, bhava sariyagirbeku." So that is very important in bhajans, in devotional singing. First and foremost thing is a good voice. That of course is God-given, we cannot manufacture it. If God-given voice is good, then it has to be cultivated. Then what we call shruti is there. Our voice should match, should get merged, get dissolved in the background instruments. Then we should sing the composition clearly. The composition of course must be of a high standard, and the songs must be very clear pronunciation. And then what is called as raga and thala, the science of music also must be added on to that. Then the grace of music will increase. And more than everything else, one should sing with devotion, with fervor. Suppose the song says something, we understand the meaning and put our whole mind and heart into it and try to express that meaning through our singing, then that type of music becomes perfect. That is how Sri Ramakrishna used to sing, Vivekananda used to sing. But Chandikanji was a great musician. The moment Holy Mother's name was uttered, he would just start shedding tears. He has composed so many songs, his mother's disciple. So, this Madhaktayatra Gayanti presupposes that the quality of the bhajan is also very good. Merely having devotion is not enough. A combination of science and devotion will be really moving our hearts and minds. Then comes bhava luntana kovida. Bhava is samsara, the round of birth and death. Luntana means destroy. Kovida is an expert. The Lord is an expert in destroying our bondage of samsara. Now what is samsara? Sri gatav. Sri means moving. Moving through what? Moving from birth to death, death to rebirth, rebirth to re-death, and so on. So this is called samsara chakra, transmigratory cycle. It is that which is really the bondage for us. The real bondage is samsara chakra. Now how does it come, or why does it come? Well, according to the philosophical works and the acharyas, some people say it is due to ajnana, some people say it is due to abhakti, lack of jnana, lack of bhakti. The bhakti schools attribute it to lack of bhakti, the jnana schools to lack of jnana. Ajnana or avidya, Shankara says, from avidya comes dvaita jnana. I see that I am here, you are there, everything else is different from me. So avidya leads to dvaita jnana, Dvaita jnana leads to kama, desire. Both desires and hatreds. I like this, I don't like that. So this kama or desire automatically leads to karma. If I see that there is something which I want to get, I try to get it. If I see that there is something which I don't like, I want to get rid of it, then I have to act, I have to work. So from avidya comes dvaita darshana, then comes kama or desire, then comes karma. Once karma is there, it has to give its result today or tomorrow. That is karma bandhana. That results in rebirth. So for samsara, the basic cause or root cause is ajnana, according to Shankara. And the bhakti schools say, no, it is abhakti. You have forgotten the Lord. You do not love Him. Once you start loving Him, everything else is done by the Lord. Now, this shloka says that He is bhava lunthana kovida. He is an expert in destroying our samsara. But how does He do it? If the root cause of samsara is ajnana and abhakti, He gives us jnana and bhakti, that's all. Very simple. He induces jnana and bhakti in the hearts of those devotees who have surrendered themselves at His feet. You know, it is very difficult to get jnana or bhakti by sadhana. Yes, there are modes and methods of sadhana described in the scriptures, but they are very difficult. Sadhana chatushtaya is there, and then viveka, vairagya, samadhi, shatka, and so on. Those who have tried to practice them know how difficult it is to practice them. But if you just surrender yourself at the feet of the Lord, O Lord, I do not know anything, you please save me. So that Sharanagati spirit will automatically induce compassion in the mind and heart of the Lord, and He will simply remove our samsara in no time by giving us jnana, by giving us bhakti. The Lord says in the Gita that He will give jnana and bhakti by which samsara is destroyed. Such shlokas are found in the Gita also. So He is bhava lunthana kovida. Then comes natha. Natheti nagashayaneti. Natha means one who is the Lord. Vadaya rakshaka. The Lord has been described by the bhakti scriptures as anathanatha, dinabandhu, dayasindhu, and so on. We are very much used to these words. We use them in our prayers. He is the Lord of the devotees, especially those who are in distress. He comes to their aid, helps them to overcome their problems, their difficulties, their troubles, gives them peace, joy, and solace. There are hundreds of stories in our Puranas which describe how great and compassionate the Lord is. Of course, the most famous examples, which are very often quoted and even which have become part and parcel of our bhajans, are how the Lord saved Draupadi, how the Lord saved Gajendra, Gajendra Moksha, and Draupadi Rakshana. As I pointed out in the beginning, in last week's lecture, a stotra need not be only in poetry. Stotra can be in prose also. And Ramanuja has written 3 prose poems, if I can use the verb. It's called Gadya. And one of them is Sri Vaikuntha Gadya. There we get this wonderful sentence, which reflects the idea of this word. Kadaham Bhagavantam Narayanam Mama Kulanatham Mama Kula Daivatam Mama Kula Dhanam Mama Bhogyam Mama Mataram Mama Pitaram Mama Sarvam Sakshat Karavani Chakshusha. When will I be able to see the Lord? Ramanuja is telling. with wholehearted feeling and devotion. He is Bhagavan, the Supreme Lord, he is Narayana. He is the master of my family, my tradition. And he is the God of my family or tradition. He is also the wealth of my family or tradition. And he is the only person who is fit to be enjoyed. All other things in this world bring us sorrow, suffering and misery. But when we are able to see the Lord and catch hold of his feet, we get the greatest joy and peace. He is our mother, he is our father, he is everything for us. We often chant the shloka, Tvameva Mata Cha. This shloka also is part of this Vaikuntha Gadya. Tvameva Mata Cha Pita Tvameva, Tvameva Bandhuscha Sakha Tvameva, Tvameva Vidya Dravinam Tvameva, Tvameva Sarvam Mama Deva Deva. So you are my mother, you are my father, you are my friend, you are my relative, you are my knowledge and wisdom, you are my wealth, in fact you are everything to me. This is how devotees with a mature mind and heart and devotion pray to the Lord. For them the Lord is everything, therefore they don't care for the petty things of the world. So this idea is reflected by the small word Natha. You are my master in every sense of the term. Then comes the next word, Nagashayana. Natheti Nagashayaneti Jagannivaseti. Nagashayana is Anantashayana. This picture of Lord Narayana lying on the serpent Anantanaga, thousand-hooded serpent, is highly symbolic. We have seen such pictures drawn by the artist. So he is lying down, resting his head on the on his arm, on his hand. Lakshmi is sitting at his feet, and then a number of gods have gathered all around him, rishis and others. They are praying to him. And the Adishesha or Anantanaga is floating on the Kshira Samudra. This is the picture. Now what is the meaning of this symbology? This Kshira Sagara can be Amrita Sagara. So the Lord is floating in infinite bliss. In other words, if you realize the Lord, if you remember him, if you meditate upon him, automatically you will also feel that joy, that bliss. If instead of Kshira Sagara, it is taken as the ocean of ordinary water, then that water is what is called primeval water, the water that existed before creation. Today science is veering around to that view. Originally, somehow the water vapor must have come, and through that life must have come into this world and so on. So it represents the Mula Prakriti, and he is lying down on that. That is, he is the origin of the whole world, that is the total symbology. Then Anantanaga, with his thousand hoods, can also represent time. It's time which is infinite. It has no beginning, no end. And his thousand hoods, thousand is actually Ananta, limitless. They represent the various divisions of time, starting with second, minute, right up to billions or billions of years. So Anantanaga is the symbol of infinite time. So time which is infinite is lying upon, that means the Lord is infinite, it is a manifestation of his power as time, Kala. Sometimes Anantanaga is also called as Sheshanaga. Adi Shesha, Sheshanaga. What does it mean? Shesha means remainder. Now one cycle of creation is over, Srishti, Sthiti and Pralaya. During that cycle, quite a good number of jivatmas have done sadhana and have got liberation. They have gone out of the samsara chakra. But still there are many, many jivas which have not obtained liberation. They remain in the Lord in a state of stupor, as it were, yoga nidra, sleeping, and they come out again in the next round of creation. So he is called a Sheshanaga because he represents the remainder of the jivas which did not get liberation in the previous cycle. So they are with the Lord. The Lord will project them in the next round of creation. Sometimes, in the language of psychology, the serpent is pictured as representing desire. Desire, kama is desire, that is represented as a serpent. In that case, we can interpret it as the Lord's desire to create the world is represented by that Anantanaga or Sarpa. Srishti is over, Sthiti is over, Pralaya is over. Then the Lord gets the desire for the next round of creation and does it through His power, by manifesting the powers and the jivas which are sleeping in Him. So, Naga Shayana, one who is lying or sleeping on the Anantanaga or Adishesha, it represents Lord Vishnu, but symbolically it represents Supreme God in the state about to start the next process of creation. Jagannivasa. Jagat is this world. Nivasa means abode, house, a place where he rests and lives. Again, this word is interpreted in two different ways. The jagat or the world is his abode. He lives in the world, or the world lives in him. Both are possible. If you take him as the antaryamin, he lives inside every one of us. He lives inside every item of creation. As we say in Kannada, ಅಣು ರೇಣು ತೃಣಕಾಷ್ಠಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮ ಹೊಕ್ಕಿದ್ದಾನೆ ಅಂತರ್ಯಾಮಿಯಾಗಿ. ಸೊ ಜಗನ್ ನಿವಾಸ, ಒನ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಮೇಡ್ ಜಗತ್ ಆಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್. ಆಲ್ಟರ್ನೇಟಿವ್ಲಿ ದಿ ಹೋಲ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಲಿವ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿಮ್. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೈ ಹೀ ಈಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಅಸ್ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಾಂಡ, ಹಿರಣ್ಯ ಗರ್ಭ. ಆಲ್ ದಿ 14 ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿಸ್ ವೂಂಬ್. ತ್ರಿಪಾದಸ್ಯ ಅಮೃತಂ ದಿವಿ ಪಾದೋಸ್ಯ ವಿಶ್ವಾಭೂತಾನಿ. ದಿ ಪುರುಷ ಸೂಕ್ತ ಸೇಸ್ the entire creation, the Prakriti as well as the Jivatmas, form only 25%, one-fourth. The other three-fourths of the Lord is beyond this. The Lord is so great, so infinite, the entire created world is just a very small part of His nature. So Jagannivasa, one who has made the world as His abode, as the Antaryami, the inner controller, or one in whom the whole world lives. Mukunda. Muktim dadati iti mukundaha. As Shankara says, Mukunda simply means one who gives mukti or liberation. These are the various names which the devotee wants to repeat. Iti alapinam mam kuru. You please make me repeat all these wonderful names of yours. How many times? Only once in lifetime? No. Pratipadam. With every step and every stage and every breath, I must be able to repeat your name. Sometimes the devotees ask, why are we instructed to repeat the name of the Lord 108 times? 108 is one mala. What is the significance? Four or five explanations are given, out of which one seems to be very simple and convincing. We breathe, according to medical sciences, 21,600 times in 24 hours. Suppose half of it is given up, night, sleeping, taking to the needs of the body. The other half is 10,800, waking state, when we are able to do something positive in our sadhana. Suppose we are able to repeat the name of the Lord with every breath, 108 actually represents 10,800, zeros can be eliminated. You repeat it, the name of the Lord for 108 times simply means gradually you must be able to repeat the name of the Lord with every breath in your waking state. If that becomes a habit, then it becomes ajapa ajapa, all the 24 hours with the breath automatically the repetition goes on. So here the devotee is telling, iti alapinam pratipadam mam kuru. Please make me repeat your name with every step in my life. Here the question comes, why? Why should I repeat the name of the Lord constantly, continuously, with every step, with every breath? Avyavritta bhajana. Now we will go back to Narada Bhakti Sutra. Narada Bhakti Sutra says that we must cultivate devotion. What are the various methods of cultivating devotion? One of the most important methods is avyavritta bhajana. Bhajana, worshipping the Lord, singing the names and the glories of the Lord, repeating His divine name continuously. By trying to do that as continuously as possible, as much as possible, you will be able to rouse the sentiment of devotion in your heart. Avyavritta bhajanat. Now why should we do it repeatedly? Can we not do it at our convenience? I do it now for 5 minutes and 3 days give a holiday and the fourth day again for another 5 minutes. No. Avrittihi asakrit upadeshat. The Brahma Sutra says that it must be repeated any number of times. Why? In the story of Shvetaketu and Gautama Aruni, the father Gautama Aruni taught Tattvamasi Shvetaketu. Shvetaketu, you are that. So he taught this 9 times continuously. 9 doesn't mean only 9. It simply means any number of times. As long as it has not taken root in your mind and heart, as long as you are not able to experience it, so long you should continue repetition, remembrance. So from this we find that avyavritta bhajana is necessary to develop real devotion in our mind, in our heart. That is why the poet is telling, let me be able to repeat your name with every step in my life. And going to the, or referring to the Yoga Sutras, there also we have a beautiful sutra which helps us in our sadhana and which is connected with the concept given here. Satu dirghakala nairantariya satkara asevito drudha bhumi. Now abhyasa means repetition, practice, spiritual practice, necessary to control our mind. It has to be done how long? Dirghakala, for a long, long time. And secondly, it must be done nirantara, without breaks. And thirdly, with satkara, with faith, with love, with devotion, with feeling. If all these three things are there, if our spiritual practice is carried on for a long, long time, and then with unbroken continuity, and with faith, love and devotion, then it becomes well-established, dridabhumihi. So just because we took initiation yesterday, and we have done a little japa today, we cannot expect to get nirvikalpa samadhi tomorrow. So we have to remember that. We do not know our samskara, where we stopped in our previous lives. So we cannot expect quick results in spiritual life. It is in our hands to do the sadhana. We should go on doing it as long as the experience has not come. Daksha Smriti says, a sannyasin has to spend his time in thinking of the Vedantic thoughts as long as he has not fallen asleep and as long as he is living. That means in our waking state, as long as we live in this world, it should continue. There are only two limits. One is actual realization, anubhuti, and the other limit is falling off of the body. Therefore, asevito dridhabhumihi in this sutra, Patanjali is telling us that it must be continued for a long, long time. In the Shandilya Bhakti Sutra also, we get a similar idea but put in a slightly different language. Avishuddhehe avaghatavati. When the mind becomes pure, real devotion for God rises there. It is only in the pure mind that devotion or bhakti in the real sense can come. So, the attempt at purifying the mind should continue. How long should I do it? Until you actually purify the whole of your mind, until devotion comes into your mind, you should continue the spiritual practice. Now there is paddy. We want to prepare rice from paddy. So we go on pounding it. We cannot just pound it for a few minutes and leave it at that. As long as rice is not obtained, so long you should continue to pound the paddy. Until the husk is completely separated and rice grains are obtained, pounding must be continued. In exactly the same way, the process of purifying the mind through yama, niyama and other disciplines should continue until devotion rises in the mind. That is why this is very important. Pratipadam alapinam kurumaham mukunda. And in this connection, you have a good number of statements in the Upanishads and the Puranas also. Anya vacho vimrut vimunchatha tamevaikam janatha atmanam anya vacho vimunchatha amrutasya esha setuhu. This is the bridge to immortality. You have to know only the Atman. All other talk, vain talk, must be given up. In other words, mind must be constantly, continuously engaged in thinking of God. Then only it is possible for us to get moksha, mukti, immortality. And then Garuda Purana, which is a wonderful Purana, it says, yan muhurtam kshanam vapi Vasudevo na chintyate sahanihi tan mahachidram sa bhrantihi sa cha vikriya. Every moment we are expected to think of God. That moment when we do not think of God, Lord Vasudeva, then that is a waste of our time. It's a great weakness. It will undermine our spiritual life. It is as good as delusion. It is as good as change. In other words, we are expected to think of the Lord constantly and continuously. If there is a break, then it is as good as harming ourselves. Of course, it's an ideal state. It's not that easy. It comes by repeated practice. Once I asked Yatishanji Maharaj, he had just given a lecture on japa. And in that he had mentioned that japa must be done as much as possible continuously. Then I asked, well, Swamiji, should we do japa all the 24 hours? He said, no, that is not possible. Then what should be done? Now in the waking state, try to repeat the name of the Lord as much as possible. Then a samskara will be created. A habit will be created. So from the conscious mind, it goes to the subconscious level.
So when the moment you rest a little from the subconscious mind, again it comes up. This is how we should create the habit. He used to tell us, fill up the gaps. Suppose you are sitting without doing anything in particular, you are waiting for the bus, or between two types of work you are just resting a little, that is the gap. Fill up that gap with the repetition of the mantra that the Guru has given. And in the Gita also we find a similar idea. Ananya cheta satatam yomam smarati nityashah tasyaham sulabhah partha nitya yuktasya yoginaha. One who remembers me with a single one-pointed mind constantly and continuously every day, I am very easy of attainment for him. So a yogi, any yogi who concentrates on me constantly, continuously, every day, thinks of me with one-pointed concentration, love and devotion, and very easy of attainment for him. We have heard of Sant Sakubai among the great saints of Maharashtra. So whatever work she did, she would always say Krishna Arpanamastu, Krishna Arpanamastu. The story goes that in her house, in the shrine, whenever the mother-in-law opened the shrine in the morning, she would see a lump of cow dung there. The mother-in-law was very much nonplussed. What is this? How can cow dung come in the shrine? And every day I am cleaning it and closing it and all that. One day she wanted to find out. So the daughter-in-law must have been possessed by evil spirit. So I must find out what is happening. So one day she was watching, and after clearing the floor after food, she took the cow dung, and the daughter-in-law, Sakubai, took it and threw it outside. But while throwing it, she said, Krishna Arpanamastu. And the result was, it came into the shrine and stuck to the feet of the Lord. Then the mother-in-law understood what a great saint her daughter-in-law was, asked for forgiveness. Well, whether the story is true or not, what is true is that there was a sense of total dedication in the mind of that wonderful lady. And we have a story in Sri Ramakrishna's parables also. There was a weaver who was a devotee of Rama. So he used to tell the people always, by the will of Rama, by the will of Rama, this happened, that happened. One day in the night around 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock, he was just sitting outside his house and resting. So four thieves were passing that way. They had robbed some houses. They had some three or four gunny bags full of stolen goods. It was too much for them to carry, so they caught hold of this fellow, come and carry this for us. So he was also carrying one bag. And then the policeman came, all the thieves ran away, and this fellow was caught. So the policeman took him and put him in the jail, and next day he was taken to the magistrate. Then the magistrate was about to sentence him. At that time, the people of the village came to the magistrate and said, no, sir, he is such a good man, saintly man, he can never steal. Something else has happened, you let us find out. Then the magistrate put him the question, what happened? By the will of Rama, I had finished my food. By the will of Rama, I was sitting outside in my house, just outside my house. By the will of Rama, four people came. By the will of Rama, they had some gunny bags. By the will of Rama, they forced me to go with them. By the will of Rama, I was carrying it. By the will of Rama, policemen came. And by the will of Rama, they ran away. By the will of Rama, the policemen caught me and they have brought me. Then the magistrate understood he is a very saintly person. So he was let off. By the will of Rama, the magistrate has let me off. Very interesting story. But we laugh at it, but for him it was natural. He could see the perceptibly see the hand of the Lord behind every act in life. That's not easy, but it can come, it can be felt by even us. Say, many times we are in difficulties in life. We intensely pray to the Lord. Somehow the response comes. We are rescued from the problems and difficulties in a miraculous way. How, we do not know. But it is true that our prayers have been answered by the Lord. Those who have the eyes to see can see. Those who have the ears to hear can hear. So when it can happen even in our own life, why not in the lives of these great saints? Again, going back to Narada Bhakti Sutra, Loke api Bhagavad Gunashravana Kirtana. You say that you have to repeat the name of the Lord with every step. You should continuously remember the Lord. But we are in the world. We are constantly engaged in performing our duties, discharging our responsibilities. How can it be done? Narada says, Loke api. Even when you are engaged in the various works and duties of the world, Bhagavad Guna Shravana Kirtana, by listening to the names and the glories of the Lord, perhaps chanted by others, sung by others, you can try to keep the mind at that level. In our Belur Math, there was a tradition in the olden days when the old sadhus living there and brahmacharins, they sit for cutting the vegetables. Every day they have to cook for 200 to 300 people. Large quantity of vegetables would be there. They have to cut them, dress them for cooking. Then at that time, one Swamiji or Brahmachari would sit there and read Vachanaveda, Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. So listening to that, they will do the work. What a wonderful way of doing things, you see. Sadhana can be continued. The mind can be kept at a higher level. Instead of talking all sorts of nonsense, we listen to that and we also do our work. That is what Narada is telling us. Loke api Bhagavad Guna Shravana Kirtanat. In the Bhagavatam itself, in the sixth skandha, it is said, Sanketyam Parihasyam Va Stobham Helanameva Va Vaikunthanama Grahanam Ashesha Aghaharam Viduhu. So, if we repeat the name of God, even by accident, or out of fun, or while making fun of somebody else, even then, that name is capable of destroying our sins and making our mind pure. Shuchirvap, yashchirvapi, yojapit pranavam sada, lipyatena sa papena, Padma Patram Iva Ambhasa. So, repetition of the divine name as much as possible, by that it is our sins are destroyed, our minds are raised to higher levels, and it is not possible to do that without the grace of God. So the devotee is praying to the Lord to make him remember him constantly and continuously. ಭಗವಂತನನ್ನು ಪ್ರತಿ ಕ್ಷಣವೂ ಕೂಡ ನೆನೆಸ್ಕೋಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಭಗವಂತನ ಅನುಗ್ರಹವೇ ಬೇಕು. ಓನ್ಲಿ ಬೈ ಹೀಸ್ ಗ್ರೇಸ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಏಬಲ್ ಟು ರಿಮೆಂಬರ್ ಹಿಮ್.